So one thing that maybe some people are not aware of, for OG, if we're thinking like, oh, they're back in OG form, they're back in TI form, they did actually say that for these qualifiers, they got Mia Stolberg also helping them out with their mind games, with their mental health mindsets, as we are in the draft. And we do, Milan, congratulations. Io and Luna actually removed by OG. And the Pango and Axe removed on the side of Team Nygma. Now that those are out, still the usual suspects in Alina, of course, comes to mind. Any more heroes that you expect to see in these first couple of picks?
Oh, Nygma goes with the first
just
pick.
Just straight up in Voga.
This is amazing. I mean, the Hellbest Meshes, the Robson team, they showed that they discovered this first pick Invoker. I mean, Storm Stormer might be the best Invoker in the world, all respect to the Miracle and others, but Storm Stormer is just another level. And he showed that Hero's that strong that he doesn't kick counters. And then Miracle is not far behind. He's like almost the same level. He's like, I can do it too.
Just do it.
And like, picking a hero first against Thompson, I think it's good. Because, like, Thompson, he doesn't play TA. And, like, I don't think there's many heroes Thompson plays that counter Invoker, actually. Like, Invoker's going to have a good matchup no matter what, it seems.
The main thing is it, like, lays down the foundation of your draft. Because, like, when you pick this hero with confidence, like, it's so much better to have a good side lane matchup nowadays. Like, picking this mid early, it's like, it doesn't feel good leaving your mid to like a later pick unless there's a like a player that needs it. Like, it's very good picking up early. And like you mentioned, like heroes that maybe beat the Invoker, I think the idea of Invoker, if you first pick it, the biggest weakness is people that collapse on your tower and try and take away your tower early on and like remove your ability to just passively farm up like the Midas plus one or a vessel, like depending on what style you want. So maybe OG will look towards just running at mid lane a bit. Maybe we get to see a rare Pugna pick.
Yeah, but the OG goes to their bread and butter, you know? It's the Magnus, and now the Team Nygma responds with the TB. Yeah, I mean, this is what you're gonna see today in this series and the other series. People are gonna pick the quote-unquote super strong heroes, you know?
Yes.
The TB and Invoker, you look at these like as the S-tier heroes in Dota, no matter what, like their spells, the Cataclysm, the Metamorphosis. Same with Magnus, you know, the RP and power. This is what, you know, it goes through BKB. They're gonna pick really strong heroes. They're not gonna mess around. And Seb might be the best Magnus in the world, you know, but it can be flex. Not to Thompson, but I've seen Sumail play a lot of Magnus lately, so he might pick it up.
Yeah, we've seen Sumail play a Magnus game, Seb as well. I do want to remind people as well that the series that Team Nygma and OG played 2 days ago was the series and the only series that we've seen Chen in action. Two games, two wins. One of them was with a Magnus where Chen was stacking all the camps for Sumail's Magnus to farm them. Is that something to you that you want to see banned out at this point? Because it's such a niche hero, right? How do you deal with it?
I think, yeah, the main thing there is it's a hero that utilized the jungle really well and had this additional healing. And I think Terrorblade as a hero, even Invoker, like, they're going to be fine playing into this Chen style because they're just going to be farming up their inside of the map and maybe they can just take that one big fight to deal with him. But it really depends on, like, how you want to deal with it. Like, it's a new hero, right? Like, if you think about Chen in the TI qualifiers, it's had two games played out of all the regions, I believe. Only on OG, 100% win rate. Like, it's not a hero
only
that
against
any...
Nygma as well.
Exactly. Yeah. It's not a hero that every team's been, like, thinking about. So I think if Nygma's done, like, the homework, then I don't think you have to ban it because it's, like, it's a great hero, but it's not, like, independently winning the game. It's, like, it's just doing the fundamentals of Dota just really well.
I want to mention the... Sorry. I wanted to mention Winter and Phoenix. I just think these two heroes are like gonna come in hot in the second phase. They bought the Winter for Nygma. We saw what it can do as a core. I mean, they already have their mid laner, but it's just one of the best heroes against Magnus. And the one hero we all forgot about, it's the Rubick, and it's a GH Rubick. It's hell of a Rubick, and against Magnus and the Hoodwink. It can be really amazing.
And this is like the benefit, right? Like, how often do you see like just mid carry as your opening, right? And it opens up for like Mind Control to have a better game. Like we mentioned so many times with Nygma, like they pop off when MC's like kind of leading the charge a lot. And yeah, I honestly like the idea of like some late pick MC hero, casual Rubick in the second. Yeah, it's actually sounds pretty good.
I mean, the first two carry mid opens really for the juicy support. Like, it opens up for the really good Ruby game, opens up for the really good Enigma game. Mm-hmm. Such, like, there are supports that, quote-unquote, carry the games. Rubick is one of them, Phoenix is one of them, Enigma is one of them, Winter is one of them. Like, if they get their spells off, they're just gonna win you a teamfight, gonna win you a game. I mean, the bans they do, the Faceless Void and Draw Ranger, they're bread and butter OG. The Thompson draw, the Faceless Void with Magnus is probably the scariest combination. And the Tidehunter and the Timber are kind of just, I think, Magnus bans. I think this might show that Magnus is a carry.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, also heroes that you don't want to see mind control. And when you're saying like you want to set up mind control for success, those are the heroes that he can take the game over with. And one of the supports that they don't want to see GH on is the Nyx Assassin. Another hero that we see can take over the game. So it's up to OG to go for their pick now. I think they want to probably hold off a little bit on their cores to make sure that they don't reveal yet who is playing that Magnus. So they pick up the Willow, and that will be the Saxa Willow. And the previous time they played it, they did play it with the Chen. And I do think we have our support duo, but I want to point out that we know that Thompson does play Hoodwink mid.
There we go.
And
yeah.
It's something you got to have in the back of your mind. I know that Team Nygma has that in the back of their minds as well. Yeah. We've not seen it in this qualifier yet, but it's out there.
I honestly think that when they pick Willow, I was like, is Nota really going to play the 5 Hoodwink? Or is this just going to be Thompson playing it mid? I just instantly kind of gravitated towards that option.
It depends on the next pick. Team Nygma might pick up the 4, and then Notia would evaluate what if Hoodwink's good matchup, or maybe they already know. I don't know. I have no idea what Hoodwink mid does. How is the matchup?
And there's the Phoenix.
There's the Phoenix. Phoenix has really good matchup on all three of these heroes. You know, especially on the Dark Willow. All his spells are like, so say ground damage, you know. Mm-hmm. So the Shadow Realm is not gonna protect you from laser, and it's really good. They're stacking up on teamfight. To beat the Magnus Willow, you need to stack up on teamfight.
That's the main thing, right? Like Nygma's looking at OG's playstyle, and it's like you can run at us, and we might die a couple times, but when we take like that game winning fight, we'll just be able to hold hands in one area, and like you can't beat us if we throw down the egg. If you know Invoker's covering the TB with his med, like. Yeah, Nygma's really going to be playing kind of on the back foot for a little bit in this type of game. So don't be surprised if OG are, you know, looking good for the first 15 or 20.
Actually, one hero the OG might pick up is the Darkseer. I always thought of Darkseer as like a really good response to TB.
Mm-hmm.
But it's a bit scary with Nygma being still able to pick up like the Ench or the Oracle, like the Oracle could be really punishing. But
this is why the double core opening is so scary, right? Like, because Nygma gets to respond twice in second phase, they've just kind of thrown down their cores. Like, how rarely do we get to talk about, like, two supports being, like, the game, like, the opening, right? Like,
oh,
like,
there goes the chance.
There it is!
And there's a chance, yeah.
Sure.
Here it is.
I think the chance says Magnus is a carry.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So it's Hoodwink mid, and then obviously Willow 4, keeping Seb's pick for last and mind control right now.
No, like, actually, I take that one back. It's
open?
They need a like empower hero, so they cannot pick really offlane empower hero.
They cannot
pick a void spirit. Mm-hmm. Yeah, they cannot pick a void spirit or Pangolier. So it could probably be like a last pick carry when they see the mind control hero. Like they pick up good matchup because Chen is already a kind of strong laner. And like they pick up the good matchup to out carry the TB and to abuse the empower and have a good lane, like, yeah, because they'll see their matchup. I mean, what does Nygma go here? They need like, they know now.
I want them to be able to like steal away the jungle. You know, like we saw how efficient Notel was at making stacks. I think right now when you have Phoenix Invoker TB, like you're not going to be running into your enemy jungle and like taking away this big resource that OG will inevitably make. So maybe mind control, go on.
They can maybe go for a Elder Titan. I think that's a good matchup on Chen, and he really likes it on GH. And it could be flexed to the offlane if they pick Agility carry with the Magnus.
They just
do the Mars.
Straight Mars. The Mars. they're fully going to the idea of like, let OG run at us and then we'll throw down our arena, our egg, we'll control with Invoker. Like, they want OG to run at them. They're kind of offering up OG to play their own game right now. But that's a scary, like, kind of defensive lineup they have.
Yep.
What can you counter pick Mars with? Sorry.
No, they are agreeing with you, Milan, in that they're banning out the Juggernaut, so they are banning out a hero that would be empowered still.
What is the good matchup on TB? I think maybe Monkey King. I think Crystal would ask for Monkey King. as a rank one Monkey King player, he would say, give me Monkey King with Empower, I'm gonna ruin them. But the Phoenix is good against Monkey King. Mars is like decent.
How about like...
It's like goes both ways.
Like an Ember, you know? Just go straight up in their face. But it's probably really bad against the egg late game. But like, it gives you that earlier in your face timing that OG normally likes to play into.
I think Ember is pretty soft.
You want to be harder?
I want a melee hero that can maybe buy a BKB, can hit the egg. Because like, if they... Like, the Lash ban? Okay, there's this other route. I mean, they did this before, so they ban it. Like... I would like... I need to check.
It's load up the hero list. Yeah, you always have to have a hero list. Oh, very helpful in these moments.
The Dora buff says PL.
Mm.
I mean, but...
Yeah.
Not sure PL against Invoker, Phoenix.
An OG hero.
Definitely an OG hero.
I don't know how much Sumail plays it, though. Vengeful Spirit coming out for Team Enigma.
Sure.
So they're going to... I mean, GH plays Venge too, so it's like, we're going to see what they do. But I would say a Monkey King for the OG.
The Crystallis effect.
Yeah, I mean, there's so many heroes banned.
But like we mentioned like PL, they're just going
Morphling.
So it's going to be... Topson would play this. Sumo's playing it, sure. Okay.
Yeah,
Offlane.
Yeah. And the Topson Hoodwink, we're going to get it. So happy to see that, because I know it's been brought up so many times on panels during drafts before, because we know he plays it. But finally getting to see it in action here against Miracle Invoker. I'm gonna ask the simple question. Who's going to take game one? Milan, you want to go first?
Yeah, I can go first. I think I got Nygma's here. Nygma is like really got the like strong heroes, and I think the OG didn't respond very well. Like they got their own heroes, regardless of what Nygma has been picking, and the TB is very strong. I think TB got this.
Yeah, I'll go, like, Nygma basically allowed OG to play their own game in the draft, and they basically picked all heroes that deal defensively with the playstyle of OG. Like, let them run at you, have an egg, have an arena, have a swap. So I prefer what Nygma has for, like, the big picture of the game, but I think that if you give OG every element of their style, then they're going to be dominant. So I'll go with the OG so that we have the one-for-one split. We got a bit more, you know, animacy on the next panel where we're like, ha-ha, OG one or something, you know? But yeah, I like the Chen. I think it's going to maybe stay undefeated, and I'll go with OG.
Yeah, I mean, stats don't lie. 100% win rate on Chen so far. So let's find out if OG can do it again, or maybe Team Nygma will take this first game of the best of three. We're finding out together with our commentary duo of SunsFan and Cinnamon.
Hello, everybody. SunsFan and Cinderin here. You look beautiful tonight, today, wherever the hell you are, Cinderin. This is quite the matchup. My good lower bracket. Did not think we'd see these two teams facing off so early. OG versus Team Nygma. We have a Chen. We have so much to talk about. I never thought I'd be excited to say there's a Chen in the game, but alas, this is 2021. He hasn't been seen. Well, we saw him one game earlier this tournament, but aside from that, basically... a dead hero for all intents and purposes. Cinderin,
I feel like it's kind of a mental pick almost, right? Like OG picked it twice in the last best of three against Nygma, and those were the two games they won, correct me if I'm wrong, in this tournament. So they're kind of just rolling it again, and you would hope Nygma, for their sake, are better prepared this time. All right, they might find. So Mail here, good stun.
Magic missile into the spear. This will be first blood for Kuroki on Team Nygma's side. That's another hero we have yet to talk about, is freaking Vengeful Spirit. I thought this guy was dead too. Where are they finding these heroes from, Sinner? I didn't know there's this many heroes in Dota.
Nygma play this hero together with Terrorblade exclusively, it seems like, and it's because of Vengeance Aura being so strong with Metamorphosis. Mm-hmm. When you turn into Metamorphosis with Terrorblade, I think he should be fine here, yeah. The damage bonus that you gain from meta is base damage, and that means that the Vengeance Aura gives you so much more extra, just oomph in the fights. I don't really think Kuro will pick it without that hero, but yeah, I'm... Looking over these strategies, I feel like there's so many times I see OG's drafts and I'm like, I wonder how this is going to work. And then it makes sense in the end. If I were to just, you just blurred out the two team names and you told me which draft you like more, it's the Dire. I think it's easier to execute. I think it's more clear cut what you're trying to do. But seeing that OG have won two chin games already against Nygma, we'll see if Notel can do it again here. Good pressure top on both teams, really. LTW.
In other words, you absolutely hate Hoodwink as a hero, and even more so as a core.
No,
because we've established
absolutely
this time
not,
and time
actually.
Again, Sindarin. Isn't that correct, Sindarin?
It has grown on me for Pro Dota, good. And I'm really curious to see it on tops on this game, actually. I wonder how this lane matchup goes. Invoker Quaswex, notoriously not very strong in lane in the first few levels against a lot of ranged heroes, but I think against Hoodwink, he might be able to break even, which would be a great start here for Miracle. And it does look like that's lane. Kind of what's happening right now.
Yeah, LTW had to pop his fairy fire to keep himself safe. Okay, we've talked about Ventral. Okay, we have so much to talk about, Sindarin. I can't even get a hold of this game anymore. But do you even know what you build on? It's been a while since I've seen Topson play the Hoodwink mid. And he was known for it for a bit, and a lot of people thought it was kind of a meme. But, I mean, he's picking it in a TI qualifier. Remember, this is lower bracket. Loser will be out. Winner goes to grand finals to fight Tundra. So still not guaranteed to go to TI. This is a TI 9. There's too many stories, Sindarin.
He's buying E-Blade. He's buying E-Blade. Come on now. It's
all right. Thank God. I was worried there for a moment.
I think in this game, when you're against Terrorblade, I actually think you want to go Maelstrom together with your Acorn shot. It's really a nice synergy these abilities have because the internal cooldown on Maelstrom, I think it's 0.2 seconds. It's ready every time the Acorn shot bounces. It doesn't bounce fast enough that you don't get the full proc chance, and it's a really good way of cleaning out Terrorblade illusions and dealing good damage. So yeah, something like Maelstrom I would like to see, and then he could go either for the Aghanim's for the Boomerang, or he could go the E-Blade if he thinks that's cool here in terms of his build, setting it up maybe for the Morphling, so Mael doesn't have to buy it then necessarily. It's a little bit cute, I think, but...
Sure, very cute. Everybody likes cute Dota, that's the reason you pick these heroes for sure.
Yes, very cute.
A lot of action top, but still no kills in this specific lane, other than that first split that we saw earlier. Okay, before we get on to the actual game itself, talk to me about Chen as a hero now as well, because Notel famously played it in the previous series in this tournament, and they owned. Why is this hero completely forgotten, and is it actually good? Or is it just like this specific thing that they're able to accomplish with it?
I feel like Chen is Chen to me is a very situational hero. It used to be in a position where you could just like first pick it a lot, but the biggest mind control almost gets Mael there. The biggest change I think is his inability to take a lot of the creeps early on. There's other nerfs that he got as Topson's actually going to solo Miracle.
Wow!
All right, I was not expecting to see that play, but that's a great start for him.
That was actually the last lane I was expecting.
Yeah,
to kill
me too. Like this feels almost impossible to find a kill in that lane for either of them, really. But nicely done. Maybe surprising him a little bit with a 2-2-0 build. It is quite a bit of damage if you've harassed at first. Mm-hmm. But yeah, about Chen, you're slower. Simply put, you can't take the stronger creeps as early as you used to. So you hit your mech timing later. You hit your Hand of God timing later. You're less powerful in lane in general, but what you still offer
top
is that major AoE.
You're
going
to have to hold your horses, Sindarin, because Kuroki has just died. Go ahead.
Guess what? Miracle just killed Topson.
Oh my god.
They're actually just taking turns, apparently. Getting the first kill in the mid lane usually makes you snowball, but Miracle gets it right back. A very interesting turn of events here. Find the kill on Kuro
top. Wants to make sure things are even. You know, it's the handicap type of thing. Want this to be as hype as possible, so we do appreciate it from a viewer perspective.
Something we didn't really cover is the Dark Willow Magnus lane. I think in one of the previous games, I had a cast yesterday with Venge Terrorblade as well out of Nygma, and we were talking about how that lane isn't very strong, especially when meta is down, you have like nothing basically. Seven Socks have done a good job at getting ahead on CS in this lane. Not by a lot, but by a bit, and finding that kill. It's gonna get harder when Kuro gets more levels. Oh, Seb's gonna have to skewer here.
Yeah. He is perfectly fine, though, as that is... I find that to be one of the more annoying voice lines in the game. The fact that ILTW is spamming, it makes it even better, though, against OG.
Oh, Seb. But, he will get stunned here.
He has skewered already, so 3 seconds on that cooldown. Gets the shockwave up with Soxa in the area. Seb is actually going to get the skewer off close to the tier 1 tower. Pops the fairy fire in turn, and will live as a result. As Chen dies, Mr. No-Tail
okay,
himself
seriously,
gets chased
though, what
down by
is
GH.
It with these unexpected kills? Like, how is Phoenix just soloing Chen in the jungle? What is going on?
I don't know what to tell you, but Thompson did lose all his mana.
No, has a Ghost Creep and a Satyr Mindstealer, and he gets solo. Like, what the hell? This is... I think I've seen, like, one or two kills in this game out of six, because I'm looking at all the wrong lanes.
Same.
Intuitively. Like, I'm trying to make a point about something, not looking at the health bars in the top, and they're just finding these seemingly... That's crazy. It's good stuff. I think these kills are good. We're going to assume they're good. Oh,
great analysis as always. Yeah, meta is popped. Kuroki's in the area with the magic missile. Gets it off, but the bramble. Great zoning capability here from Soxa. Very easy to use, and that'll save Seb yet again. So the one lane that we've been talking about so much, they've barely had any actual action turn into a kill as Thompson getting chased in the mid lane. GH with a couple fire spirits. Thompson doesn't have a level of scurry yet, so can't really go through those trees. Actually uses the sharpshooter, but GH... we'll be able to sidestep it. And Thompson's going to be able to get this bounty now, and back to mid you go. So between the two mid laners, basically a wash in terms of net worth. A little bit in favor of Miracle because he got the second kill, but overall pretty even in that lane.
Yeah, the question for me is who has the bigger impact in 5 minutes, right? Like, is it the Invoker that shows up with a vessel, or is it Hoodwink that shows up with whatever Thompson is planning? Currently power treads, actually. Interesting to see. Miracle's really laying into him here. There's no mana on the Hoodwink after that EMP. Definitely pressuring him quite a lot here.
Yeah, and they're really even on levels as well. As top lane, Shadow Realm is popped from Soxa. He's going to get gone on by Kuroki, though. Wand will keep Soxa alive. Seb gets set up very nicely by that Curse Crown into the skewer. Bramble to follow, but Kuroki, he knows his way around the maze, Cinderman, and will live as a result of this. It feels like every... player in this lane is perpetually at low HP, but no kills, really.
They're definitely
Let's just stop casting that lane.
They're playing a lot on pressure, which is really good to see, right? Like, you have this Venge Terrorblade lane, but you're not just sitting back and trying to farm and being like, okay, well, our lane has nothing. You're playing strong when you are strong, and then they're kind of just weathering the storm outside of that. I think this top lane's been very well played by Nygma in particular, actually. Terrorblade is 700 net worth behind the Morph, though, which is concerning, but given the circumstances, Samael's lane is just easier. Like, playing Morph against Mars, if you have a head start from Chen, is just so easy. Mars can never really burst you if you're on your toes, you have more damage, your range.
No-Tail getting caught out, Tornado EMP surrounded by GH and Miracle. Miracle takes credit for that one. Something we've failed to mention so far because we've had so much to talk about, Sindarin. From Sumail's perspective, I'm assuming this is an Ags game, right? You just turn it to the Dark Willow and go ham?
Yeah, for sure.
Is that kind of the idea behind it?
Yeah, I think so. He might stop for something else on the way, though. I wonder, like, he's currently hovering a Void Stone. Usually when Morphs buy this, they build it into Lincoln's. I don't think there... Is there anything else interesting he would buy with a Void Stone? Not really. So... we'll see if he changes his mind. But if he does go for that, it kind of indicates Lincoln's, which I don't know if it's good here. Oh, Miracle again.
Oh, wow.
Combining with ILTW though for this one, and they did combine beforehand for the kill mid as well with GH. So good movements coming out, and you love to see this from Invoker, right? You get those two earn charges from the first kill, and you're immediately hungry elsewhere on the map, because it just makes your hero so much stronger. Cold Snap earn, go on anyone you want, and just keep this ball rolling for Miracle. Obviously, worth keeping in mind, this is a hero that's basically been respect banned against Nygma every game this qualifier. And OG choosing to give it to Miracle here is it's definitely a sign of confidence in trying to, like, just beat them at their best, kind of.
Yeah, we have Ghostwalk on Miracle top lane. He spots out a bunch of heroes. If they can get Thompson again, that would be pretty crippling for him. but wraps back around, and it looks like he's not going to go for anything as of yet.
He's waiting here for seven. If Kuro connects with a swap, this can be a kill. You can swap mid-skewer to interrupt the movement. They're going to go for it, I think. There we go.
Yep, gold snap, magic missile, EMP. Oh, the swap into the EMP, like you said, and that'll be it.
Nice kill.
So nice, easy kill. That's going to give another earn charge for Mr. Miracle, who is pretty close to finishing off the Spirit Vessel. I assume this is going to be the same build we've been seeing throughout the Major and whatnot, into Midas, so you can get the Cataclysm combo and all that good stuff.
Oh, they're looking for Soxa. He can't TP out. He's cold snap earned.
Yep,
so he's stuck here. He's dead.
He's donezo.
Miracle's getting so much work done this game. He's going to almost have the vessel now. 10 minutes in. 42 CS is not bad on Quaswex Invoker. Minute 10.
Yeah, true.
A lot of mid heroes will be really dissatisfied with this, like, say, TA or Shadow Fiend or, you know, these farming mids. But on Invoker, it's completely fine when you're making these moves on the map. He's top net worth in his team by far. And just getting 4 of the 6 kills he's been involved in. Once this vessel comes out, you open some new doors. Like, maybe you can kill the Morphling. You can easily stay on the target you've been killing so far, even though Hand of God becomes available. You largely negate the Chen mech for a long time. So, why is Somail buying Lincolns?
That is strange. I mean, is swap something he's super worried about? It is an instant cast. Well, so we're going to see that use
swap.
Top lane. Yeah, the skewer comes off, though. Mind Control gets off his arena. This looks to be yet another easy kill for Team Nygma. Although, Hannah God keeping him safe for now, but another magic missile will come. He actually uses RP to try to get away, but it ends up failing in the end. Now Soxa has come, has the Terrorize, doesn't want to pop it yet though. Gets the Bedlam, but the spear,
nice spear
against the wall, and they could potentially turn this around as Somail on the backside, available here. They're going to lose another hero though for Team Nygma in terms of their advantage. Just 10-2 right now, looking really good.
That was such a big outplay from Kuro and Mind Control there. Just beautiful stuff, really. They use the arena, they don't spear, and they end up killing Mag without using it. And then when Soxa connects and starts going on Kuro, Mind Control finds the spear right before he gets stunned by Cursed Crown. So just outplaying every single move OG were making there, and in the game in general. And it looks like they might be looking for more here. Miracle is hovering around. No vessel yet, 50 gold to go. So probably not going to pick Morphling as the target. But
yeah, he's doing
great
a
target
lot
here
of
would be the Willow.
He is doing so much scouting with this Ghostwalk, I have
Soxa
to say.
Soxa is basically already dead here. It's a matter of how much can he get done.
Egg is popped. Somail. Oh, the Deafening Blast with the spear is going to keep the egg alive, and it will pop as a result. But Somail already gets his attribute shift off. He actually gets poked back into the arms of Somail. Gets a nice adaptive strike off as well as GH with the heal from the sideline. Nygma are extremely low right now. They're going to lose Miracle to start things out. Looks like Kuroki is next. So a nice turnaround from OG. As they get three, this is going to be a close to a wipe as ILTW is nowhere to be seen, Sindarin. Mind Control onto the high ground. Couple more right clicks from Somail, adaptive strike, shockwave. Oh, the arena is placed, but not in time.
I was
four
sure they were
going to
kill Soxa
trade,
there.
Aside from the tier one bottom that ILTW is getting.
Soxa started that fight using Shadow Realm, and I think he got Cold Snap earned, but somehow Nygma's hero just couldn't get to connect on him, just got zoned off. Maybe it was a good bushwhack. I didn't really see. It was kind of weird, but obviously it's easy for us to say with the full vision that we have of the two teams. I guess from Nygma's perspective with the vision they had, that just wasn't clear-cut at all what they could have done there. Oh, we're not done yet. We're going to go immediately onto No Tail.
Yeah, but you can see the spirit
vessel
with
the cold
snap, tornado. Nope. Going to connect on the creeps. That'll be very disheartening for No Tail, but the Sunstrike being dodged. Very nicely done. And he's going to live as a result again. Gets out the tip as well. So we did see ILTW solo that bot lane. I mean, is that a fight where... I mean, again, you talked about hindsight and us having vision and whatnot. Is that a fight that you would expect a Terrorblade to show up to?
Not really, no. I think, given how that started, if they don't get this perfect control on Miracle really fast, I do think that could have been very clean for Nygma. Having that Shadow Realm used early means if you get caught by any spear or anything when you come out of it as well, you're just instantly dead. But Soxa managed to weave through the tree line really nicely to set something up. Yeah, Terrorblade doesn't need to join that.
So talk to me about Magnus as an offlaner. Obviously, we've seen it. I mean, it's a flex here between mid and offlane a lot of the time. I mean, we've seen it some support as well, but not having a true empower here. You get the bonus damage, obviously, on Morphling, but... don't really get cleave. Is that actually an issue at all? Because typically we see the if you want an empower partner, it's something that help amplify the farm early on, like a PA or whatever heroes that need items to farm.
Empower is pretty good on Morphling because he has insane base damage, right? Oh, Seb's dead.
Swap.
And this time I'm confident.
EMP. Are you confident? He makes it to the high ground and then dies. His dead corpse is there with Sindarin's name on it. The egg was popped as well.
He did not get mech off. That might have actually saved him. They also find tops and bottom with mind control and ILTW.
I love this from ILTW.
Instant TP mid. Like, two dead heroes, I'm going to push this tower with my mech.
Yeah, he's going to apply a lot of pressure to the tier 1 tower, and there's the tornado with the meteor coming down onto Noto. He's going to live, though, with the help of Sumail. Terrorizes there onto Miracle. He's going to get bursted down like none other. So ends up being a 2-for-1 across the map here. I was going to say, I've seen one Topson death, and how many deaths does he have right now? He has 3. So he's kind of all over the place.
Bit too overzealous from Miracle there. I think if he doesn't try to dive, they actually just get the tower. But trying to dive that Chen got him really out of position, and Soxa with a very quick punish. And not only that, but this is even a siege creep wave. This is like perfectly aligned for OG to push their own.
Oh, swap Topson magic missile. Topson looks potentially dead again, but the nice mech coming out. Keeping him alive, and now Kurogi might be the sacrifice. There's an RP, it's only onto ILTW, but this will be an enormous kill if they're able to get him. Oh, sorry, that was Minecraft. They look very similar, Cinder. You know, the Mars and Terrorblade, very similar indeed.
They both have teeth.
Huge bodies, totally different colors, very easy to mistake.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they're both heroes.
GH in the meantime gets blown up as well, and somehow OG has just turned this around. It feels like when they're behind, they play better. I don't know if that's just me. It really feels like something that's deep inside them.
The thing that's so beautiful about this is how fast everything happened, right? So Nygma find 2 good kills, they go push mid, 1 overextension from Miracle, and OG get, was that 3 kills, a tower, and straight into Roche. Like, all of this happened within 1 minute. It's so quick and so punching. Nygma know this is happening, though, so they're going to try to go and connect. And this, honestly, this could get scary for OG. They don't have RP. And Nygma have everything except Supernova. No, they even have Supernova. Oh my god.
Ult comes out onto 4. Nobody's even in the pit right now. Here comes the Meteor to follow. Topson dies right at the beginning of this fight. Deafening Blast is not really going to connect on anything. Is the Egg also not going to connect? But there's a huge Terrorize on basically everybody from Team Nygma. Can they follow it up with anything is the question. Doesn't look like it for now. Sumail Wavestorms through. They've lost 2 so far. The buyback now onto Soxa, but they're going to lose Seb as well. Buys back into the game as well. This Roche is extremely important for them. Based on the buybacks, if nothing else. And with that, Nygma will back up. This was without Metamorphosis, by the way, which is up in 7 seconds.
Yep. The Supernova and Arena have been used now, though. So OG might feel confident that they can eventually just slowly wither down and claim this Roche like this. But Invoker, one of the best heroes at stalling.
Indeed.
Meta is up.
Mind Control jumps in, the spear will completely whiff, and he's going to get decimated as a result. But Seb, this might be a dieback, he skewers on the other side. It'll be a trade in the end, though. 3 from Nygma now on the run. Kuroki trying to make his way to safety. Doesn't look like it's going to happen, but okay. The sharpshooter actually connects on Miracle, but either way, Kuroki finds his way to the grave. And the Roshan is still not dead yet, Cinderman. ILTW has a meta up and running. That's a buyback now from Kuro. I think I'm able to get this. Bushwhack not going to connect, but the delay is there. The Bramble, extremely annoying. Tornadoes seemingly have 0 cooldown in this game. As Sumail trying to solo this Roche, it is taking so freaking long to get it, and he gets it in the end. Jesus, Gaben. Finally, this Roche fight has ended as Nygma. Well, I was going to say they're on the run, but maybe not. Egg is on cooldown for 26 seconds. All right, we can take a little bit of breather as Soxa dies. Breathe it in for Soxa, give him the old F. As Kuro gets off the magic missile, getting healed.
Oh, nice sidestep.
Whizzes right by him. This is one action-packed game.
Yeah, I love when the team won on that move.
Thank you so much. You're the best co-casters
honestly,
anybody
like,
could ever ask for.
The thing that's so cool about this is that OG coming out with the Aegis is the only reason we can declare a winner there. Like, outside of that, it was trade-off for buybacks, it was good cooldown usage. They're really playing on the limit of what they feel like they can pull off, right? OG going for that Roche after the mid-tower might seem really greedy because they don't have RP, but they're doing it knowing that there's no meta on the other side. Okay, this is a mega-dead set, by the way. Sunstrike. So they're kind of playing it on the limit, right? And then Nygma feel like they can contest because they have exactly the tools that they do. They just get Supernova in time, they go and contest. Then with the buybacks OG come back with, they have numbers, and now with the big cooldowns, they think that slowly but slowly they can get it. It's just, it's honestly just really good play overall in decision making to pull this off, really, from both teams. OG do eventually get the Roche, but if Nygma don't go and contest there, OG get it for free. At least this way they had to pay for it quite a lot. Radiant's
bottom tower is under attack. I mean, how important for this game is the Roche? I know that sounds like a stupid question, but a lot of times when you take the Roche, you don't really do anything with it. Is this a lineup that OG can take advantage of in terms of getting more map control or potentially trying to go past the tier 2 towers?
I don't think you get past tier 2s yet. I just don't think you're strong enough to just bulldoze down the lane. Nygma have insane teamfight between Invoker, Mars, and Phoenix. You're always at risk of getting swapped. Of course, you have the Lincolns, like we talked about, so that can help a little bit, but there's ways of breaking it, right? Just a quick cold snap can break it. Honestly, that's kind of the only thing, though, so that's kind of cool, I guess. But yeah, I still wouldn't advise OG to just bulldoze a lane. You use this Aegis to try to pressure, maybe you find a tier 1 tower bot, or maybe a tier 2 tower top, but you probably don't look at high grounds. And more than likely, the move you make should be included in the smoke, where you smoke mag and morph together, and find a skewer kill. With the E-Blade, is probably the timing here, 1k gold away for Samil. It's a very big power spike for their lineup to get this E-Blade.
Yep, for sure.
Yeah, I think that's what they're going to do. Just play the map, wait for that one timing, and then go for something. They're setting up top already as the next objective. But will they wait for E-Blade or not then? Maybe they just go. This is the hardest tower for Nygma to defend in the game, so probably you're going to see them sell it. Taking this tower is very, very easy with Aegis compared to the other tier 2s, just because of positional advantage the attackers have. In both bottom and mid, the defending team have more angles.
Yep, GH showing himself with that Sunray. He's
delaying a
bit. Healing up the shard for himself, but like you said, it looks
Wolf
like
behind.
They might just give this up.
Samil hits so freaking hard. He has Wolf Aura and Empower level 4. Like, I think he got plus about 60% damage here from these two.
Plus the Empower? Yeah, it's quite a lot.
It's strong. Radiant's bottom tower is under
attack. I mean, but if you look at the net worth, this is a very even game. You can see from ILTW's perspective, he is obviously farming really well. Went for a defusal, by the way, as a third item. Not the most common thing. Obviously, I would assume this is against the Morphling, if nothing else, to try to drain that mana.
It feels like the carry you buy defusal against. Yeah, it's just that. Like, it's also one of the few carries that you would even see Gyros buy defusal against. Once Morph is mana burned, his impact is just very, very limited.
Oh, we're gonna have E-Blade to wait for him from Sumail. Kuro staying alive just a little bit longer. The meta's caught by LTW. Alright, that is the Aegis. They got the tier 2 and the Aegis to follow. Here's the Marzarina on top of the egg. The Terrorize is used on a couple of heroes, but this is not gonna turn into any kills, at least not yet. It looks like everybody's able to retreat successfully.
It is a really good Terrorize, though. Without this, Morph dies. He absolutely has to cast it to save Samael. He's caught in the wall of the arena. There's Vessel. There's a Terrorblade just laying into him. Chen's heals are relatively insignificant in that instance, so... Yep. Good Terrorize. And now that meta is used, OG could look for their own move. Like, yeah, you've expended Hand of God, but I think this trade-off favors you. There's no Supernova either.
They just got scanned, so Nygma are aware of this, no doubt about it. So while we wait for this failed gank, I assume it's going to be a failed gank to come. We can talk a little bit about items. Maelstrom is done for Thompson. He is 300 away from finishing Aghanim Scepter. Okay, this is a hero we have yet to actually discuss in depth, Sindarin. And I say that very sarcastically because we've talked about probably an hour's worth about Hoodwink.
Is he
going
to find
mind control? Oh
my god, he was close to seeing him.
I think he did see them and he just didn't realize. It's like, there's no way there's a Mars in this game, right? This is Dota. That doesn't sound very lore-friendly. Anywho, what do you think of Ags with the Boomerang?
I think it's pretty good, especially with Morphling. Like, marking a key target for the Morphling to kill is very strong. It's just the overall amplification of it in a game where... Honestly, a lot of this is just going to come down to who gets the first pick, right? Like, that's what you want in this game. You have a Blink Skewer versus a Avenge Swap. So getting that immediate key kill is really big. I still have to fully like start appreciating the ags on Hoodwink without having lens. I think having cast range limitations can be annoying on this hero. Because yeah, like if you cast a boomerang, you kind of expose yourself in this game. Like you can then get caught by level 2 swap, or you can get caught by Mars Arena, you can get caught by a tornado at any point, right? But his next item is going to ensure that that doesn't happen. He's just queuing up a BKB as his third item here, and I really like that from Thompson. I think it's a great choice. Just to ensure that you get to land that key spell and dish your extra damage.
Yeah, the fact that it gives you minus 25% status resist with a lineup that has Magnus RP sounds kind of scary.
Yeah, there's some decent synergy.
Spell damage. We have a smoke now from Nygma. ILTW is showing the illusions here. He is working towards a Scotty next, not super close, just has the one ultimate orb for now.
Thompson gets swapped, about he's the just instantly dead. Alright, they're just gonna get rid of Reno.
He's dead. You got the sharpshooter off though. What happens when you die with sharpshooter? It looks like it goes off successfully into the wind. 50 seconds on the deck, no buyback, but big terrorize into an RP! But there is the Phoenix heal from the sideline, as now Sumail getting four staff to safety. Tornado's gonna connect with that Spirit Vessel applied. He turns into Phoenix though, dives to safety.
So clutch
looks
for
like
No-Tail,
okay,
dude!
For now. Oh. No-Tail, he's the one getting chased now. The Fusil Blade is enough to easily take him out. So 44 right now. They take out the Mars in the turn. Miracle is in so much trouble. He gets dropped like nothing. And Sumail, I thought he was out of there, but he goes back in to fight. Really well done.
Oh my goodness. That was so clutch from No-Tail. All right, hang on. We're not done yet.
Swap. Magic Missile. These heroes are all over the place. ILTW pops the meta. They want to fight for sure. Curse Crown is applied to him as Kuro's getting chased by Sumail. We'll just assume he dies here. Looks like Seb's going to get to safety, though, in the meantime. And GH, oh, Sumail might be in some trouble. Gets off the attribute shift, though. Doesn't want to be in the vicinity of ILTW, of course.
Okay, so basically the way Nygma start that fight, they kill the Hoodwink for free. Oh, well, they use Arena, right? And then we get this good RP coming out from Seb with Morph on top, but they cast Vessel on Morph, they start laying into him, he's used E-Blade defensively, so he can't save himself. But guess what? When he gets Tornado in the river, a little Satyr creep walks in, and with one purge, removes Tornado and Vessel.
Oh,
it just
nice.
Sneaks up the river and full-on saves the Morph, gives Sumail a reset, and he can come back in and find that Miracle kill and eventually get out. The little Satyr that could. That probably saved the entire fight, to be honest. I think Sumail is dead there, and Miracle lives, and then Nygma get extra kills on the way out.
Damn.
So, huge. It's
the
little things sometimes.
The play of the game
I mean, that's
something
the thing
that
with
you would
Chen, right?
barely like, ever see.
There's always this. There is always the potential, right? It's just that a lot of the times you don't find these moments where you theory craft what the hero can do with these neutral creeps, right? Like, Ice Armor can be amazing, the Purge can be amazing, the Auras can be amazing in the right moments, but a lot of the time you don't find the moment, even if it exists in the game, but No-Tail finds it there. Really, really key moment from him. Dude, this game is so close, actually. It's really close.
No-Tail is working on a shard, by the way, so that allowed Divine Favor to be cast on allies, which gives you the old TP back.
Yeah.
Seb, okay, he actually stunned himself there. Mind control, okay, the Cataclysm, he's just obliterated.
Sometimes you just die, you know.
Yeah, horribly.
I wonder how many times they could have killed him there in a row if he just respawned instantly.
Mini game. Somebody add that to the arcade.
Probably
please.
Three or four times. They had a lot of damage. But yeah, I gotta say though, like, the gold is even in this game, 2k lead for Nygma, but if you, let's try to think a little bit ahead here in the game. I don't. Oh, Soxa. Whoa! He just walked in there. All right,
he did.
That's
he's speared.
Not
he's dead.
Well. Nygmar definitely covering that angle. So okay, let's say this game progresses. Right, you go later in the game. You have Invoker, Phoenix, and Terrorblade, arguably three of the single best late game heroes in their individual positions. Invoker gets crazy when BKBs get low. Phoenix, in my book, perhaps the single best late game support on average when it has all the levels and a refresher. And then Terrorblade, one of the best late game carries. What do OG have that matches? I think Chen falls off. You just undoubtedly will be weaker, right? Or compared to these other heroes. Then you have the Mag Morph, which As we've talked about, the Empower is nice, but it can get a little awkward, and once Aeon Discs come out, you kind of counter mag to a larger extent. So I think a lot of what OG has to do to win this game actually has to come from Soxa. That's going to be the hero I'm looking at. You need huge Terrorize, you need to maybe isolate a hero with Bedlam so you get ahead in the fight. It's just... I don't know, man. I think OG has played a really, really good game. But for me, strategically, this is when the real battle begins. You didn't get ahead with your Chen strategy. Now you're 30 minutes in against Aegis and Cheese. This is,
they definitely
this is gonna
have
be hard.
An uphill battle to fight, for sure. The Shard, I'm actually not 100% sure who took it. It's either the Phoenix or the Invoker. But either way, I think maybe GH had the Shard already. It's the Sunray through Egg, obviously.
So
Miracles is the triple meteor, meatball surprise.
The Shard one is great with Mars, right? I kind of like the old Shard concept. I feel like it could have been worked on a bit more. The Vector Ice Wall. I think that was a cool idea. But
yeah.
I wonder why that got removed so fast. ILTW?
Oh my goodness. All right, Boomerang onto ILTWs. We have the Mars Arena out. Thompson's in a lot of trouble. Cataclysm to follow. He's going to get clipped by a couple of those Sunstrikes. Puts out a tree. I thought he tried to go to the low ground, but it didn't work. Is he still stuck here? The Sunray doing so much damage, but Thompson finally finds his way out. RP was used. Only connects onto Kuroki, and Seb is going to pay with his life. It's going to cost him Kuroki, though, so it's a one-for-one trade, but that's an offlaner for a position five.
All right, tell me
tier
this.
Tier 2 is destroyed.
You get a zero-man RP, and the enemy support dies. Are you happy you got a kill, or sad that you missed the RP?
Probably the latter.
Yeah, probably me too. That was just not good. There's no need to sugarcoat that. Seb just blinked RP'd the ground, and he even had the ward vision. He had vision advantage, just airballed it completely.
Well, to be fair, they did get Aegis, so that is something.
They did.
Right? I mean, it didn't come...
It was a really good job.
It wasn't because
down
of the RP.
Right? Yeah, that is correct.
I mean, if you're trying to, you know, when you're in a team, you need somebody to, you know, boost the team up a bit. You can include the RP as part of the reason that you got the Aegis, but deep down inside, you freaking know that it had nothing to do with it. You know, just one of those things. You gotta play the mind games with your own team sometimes.
But
Thompson has a BKB.
They have the single target damage, right? So the way they kill ILTW, you obviously have the E-Blade morph, you have the Boomerang, as well as the Dark Willow with Bedlam if needed. If you connect all these things, you can definitely kill him. He's playing without BKB on Terrorblade until now. He just got it, so now it gets a lot harder. But yeah, OG, they do get the Aegis away, but it's still a 3k gold swing the way of Nygma in the following minute. So they are gaining more and more on the map. Mars closing in on Deso will be a huge damage boost to the Terrorblade. Obviously applying that with God's Rebuke, very strong. Miracle.
Yep,
saying hello to Seb.
EMP wants to blink to safety, but Thompson is in the area. Has another Scurry available. Bushwhack will not hit, though. And Miracle, he's going to be spotted, though. The Force Staff with no tail, with the Penitence applied.
Can he blink?
Look at that
yes.
Slow. What a spell. He blinks to safety, though. All right, Thompson now might be in some trouble, but pops that BKB. Sharpshooter with the Boomerang. That's a lot of damage. Terrorize onto a couple heroes. But here comes Mind Control with the Arena, only onto no tail, though. And it looks like Miracle did find his way to the grave regardless, so not able to save him. Because now Mind Control will be the sacrifice as well. So a double kill for Sumail. What started as a chase that I thought he was going to be able to get out of. Nygma.
Miracle had the choice of running there. He was safe. He was out. And then, because of the getting the blink off, he thought there was a turnaround on Thompson there. But that BKB, I think Miracle didn't account for it. He went to Vessel and Cold Snap him, and he just got Acorn shot bushwhacked on the Invoker and died. He doesn't have BKB yet, so obviously getting caught there is a kill.
During your monologue, Kuro's been running this whole time.
Yeah,
it's just a huge marathon. He gets the bounty rune. He wants to use his spells because, you know, they're available. He does die. It takes a while to kill him.
That's a heads-up play from OG, though. Taking advantage of that misstep from Miracle. And Miracle's team trying to help him there just gives them bonus kills and the tower. All right. I guess OG just got 5k gold out of this one kill. That's something.
And I mean, that's the thing when you play against
OG. And it just shouldn't
OG,
have happened, right?
Correct me where I'm wrong here, Sindarin, because we see a lot of this from OG, but they play so aggressive. Sometimes it looks like the wrong move, but it works out in their favor sometimes, sometimes not, obviously. But at the very least, you're controlling the tempo, right? Yeah. Feels like Nygma are almost forced to play the way that OG are in some cases, or they get baited into, whereas OG are the ones more comfortable playing that way.
But I think in this particular moment, it was Miracle's choice. Like, he escaped the hyper-aggression that you just talked about, the chase. He got away and chose to turn. So
that's my point, though. If you're not playing against OG, maybe you don't make that move.
Right, I see what you mean.
Mm-hmm. You know?
It's definitely a lot of pressure on you. It goes really fast. Yeah, absolutely.
Oh, we have a smoke. My thrift reward. And they're coming. Oh, Mind Control jumps in, gets the rebuke off Sumail. Doing so much damage here, but now he's stuck inside the arena. Here comes the Cataclysm on top with the egg on the sideline. Sumail's in a lot of trouble, stuck inside this arena. GH, with that Sunray, doing massive damage, as it looks like this is going to be an easy fight for Nygma. Double kill for ILTW, beautiful smoke execution. Thompson, with the sharpshooter in the trees. Again, not able to connect on it. Seb on a cliff, pulling the Arteezy, but Mind Control can get up there with the rebuke. No, not enough.
Wow, I can't believe he survived that, actually. That was really cool. Really great execution from Nygma there, though. They find the flank on the smoke, and I loved what Mind Control did. His smoke breaks, but he doesn't instantly blink arena. He gets in, he gets a little bit of information, and then he finds his key target, which is the Willow. He walks in, BKBs, and makes sure to lock that down, because without that Terrorize, there isn't that disengage reset button that OG desperately need when they get jumped on. It's been Soxa this game saving them in a lot of bad situations. And Mind Control just took that away from them, and this is easily one lane, maybe even two. So Mail's dead for 40. It could look like your skewer, but...
No buyback. Meta is on cooldown for a long time, but ILTW still has the cheese, so not super scared at the moment.
Enigma's gonna respect this. They don't know if Morph has buyback, and it can get dicey with a Blink Skewer in their own base, so... Paying respect to OG.
GH has a refresher, by the way. I don't know if we mentioned that.
I have not. So, and now he's going disc, egg. Which we talked about.
Yeah. The item of the patch that, I don't know if you feel the same way, would not be sad if it was literally deleted instead of just nerfed. Maybe the nerf is being deleted.
I'm down with that if you remove status resistance too, then. That's a trade I'll take.
No!
Let's do that.
Cinderin, why do you have to be that kind of a guy? Huh? Why? Status resistance is cool.
Yeah, very cool.
That means you don't have to buy BKB literally every game. That's the beauty of status resist. But you still have to.
I suppose.
You still have to buy the BKB, but it makes it seem like you don't.
The tier 4 item for Invoker. It's either that or Spell Prism. Those are the ones you want to see if you're Miracle. And they get the other one as well.
Which one's more important?
Probably give the Prism to Terrorblade. Or does he want to have the Sliver? I'm just thinking you can spam out way more map pressure with Conjure Image. Mm-hmm. You get lower cooldown Metamorphosis. He's actually taking the Prism on Invoker, so... Okay, so GH will get the Relic. That's also a good split. I think that's fine. Radiant's courier
has been killed. Yeah, I mean, you gotta talk about...
GH does a lot of damage.
Sliver. In terms of the Titan Sliver heroes, I mean, Terrorblade has gotta be top two.
Oh, right, it's a TB. Of course you want the Sliver for the base damage. Yeah, no way. You definitely keep that one.
Usually the 20% base damage is like, it's not that much. It's the other stats that are important, but for him, it's very nice.
Look at it. So they got Telescope as well. So now Kuro gives him bonus attack range. He has basically permanent double base damage.
Oh, Cinder, man. We got the arena. Soxa looks to be dead at the start of the fight, but the RP from Seb comes on the sideline, but the BKB already popped by LA2W. And there's the buyback now from Soxa as the egg forces everybody out. Seb on the run. BKB no more. You see him power off just before. Now Miracle applying some pressure to No-Tail. This fight is very segregated. Swap onto ILTW. Still has his Sunray, but there's the Terrorize. Do they have the damage to actually burst through him? With the Sunray coming through as well. Try and heal as much as he can. But Soxa with the Bedlam, that is enough. Terrorblade is dead. Does have buyback, though. It's going to cost Sumail, though, if he's not careful. Trying to heal up through this Sunray, but it's not going to happen. A triple kill for Miracle, as he is just going ham right now. Fully healthy as well. With that Spell Prism in his inventory. Soxa gets off the Yules for now. Seb on the sideline. He cannot do anything with this Cold Snap Spirit Vessel combination. Ultra kill for Miracle. He's looking for more, but now he's a little bit low. Soxa gets off the Shadow Realm, but Miracle's gonna live for now. Looks like he's gonna be okay. Looking for No-Tail on the sideline now. Goes up to the high ground. He wants his Rampage Cinder Man. I don't know if it's too late. He gets it. Rampage for freaking Miracle. He's now inside the arena. The triple meatball surprise as Sumail has to wave for him to safety. Only he and Hoodwink are alive, but maybe not for long. This could be a dieback onto Thompson, and it is just that. A double rampage for Miracle. And that might be it for game one. Holy jeez.
And I was, honestly, I was going to compliment OG in that situation for finding the kill on Terrorblade. I feel like there's like, there's less than a handful teams in the world that even find that kill after the way that fight started. It was incredible spellcasting to make them get this kill on LTW, but Nygma supporting cast, GH with two amazing supernovas. Oh. They're going to find Hoodwink here. BKB is ready.
Skewered back into the brunt of things. Stops with the BKB. He's just melting under the pressure. And Sumail looks to be next. He finds Kuro, but that looks like it's going to be the only kill for him. He's getting his attribute shift off, though. But the Sunray coming through with that Spirit Vessel, there's not a whole lot to be done. And that'll be basically it. It's, oh, the skewer onto two, into the fountain, not quite in range to get both of them. And the GGs come out. Nygma, game one victors, best of three, lower bracket, to see who faces Tundra in the grand finals. Man, that was a lot of fun to cast, I'm not going to lie.
I think to Hopefully everyone's surprise, this game was really high skill. So there's obviously, there's a handful of moments to pick away at in this game, but really, I feel like the end thing that wins Nygma this game is they got the second Roche, right? They got the second Roche, and they build a big advantage with it. They hit a strong item timing, and in my mind, their lineup just scales better. So I think OG actually did a really, really good job at fighting them, but they never got ahead, and ultimately, I don't think this Radiant lineup is going to win late game unless it hits like some sort of money Ravage, which Seb struggled to find. I think he got one good Ravage off the whole game, which is credit to Nygma's great positioning. But yeah, I find OG's lineup incredibly challenging to like understand and to play, but they made some insane individual and combination plays that made it look great at times. But in comparison to their other Chen games, they didn't find that mid-game advantage, and that's the huge difference right. maker. That doesn't let No-Till really dictate the pace of the game anymore.
That was a beast of a game one. I won't lie, Sindarin.
I liked
you
it.
You sound very excited. You might need a little tweak to the code inside your brain to get hyped up for game two. I don't know if you can handle another one, but you'll have to because we would continue on as game two will be coming up soon. Let's go to a quick break, and then we'll see what the panel has to say about this amazing opener for this lower bracket final.